Hi everybody. Up to this point, all of our videos have focused on quantum mechanics. We've looked at the quantized sets of energy levels for electrons or atoms or molecules, but so far we really haven't talked at all about temperature. For the next several videos, we're going to look at statistical mechanics. That's where we think about the probabilities that each of the quantized energy levels will be occupied. Statistical mechanics is sort of the link between quantum mechanics and the macroscopic laws of thermodynamics, which you've probably seen before and which we'll cover later in the course. Even though we haven't yet quantitatively talked about temperature, you probably have an intuitive sense of certain things. You probably know, for example, that systems are more likely to populate low energy states. We often talk about lower energy states as being more stable, and you've also seen things like the Aufbau principle, where electrons tend to populate the lowest energy atomic orbitals before they populate higher energy orbitals. You probably also have a sense that higher temperatures tend to increase the probability of populating excited states. You know, for example, that higher temperatures tend to make reactions more likely to happen, to cross over transition state barriers. But what we're going to do now is to quantify these ideas. This expression is the definition of a Boltzmann factor, which may be the most important concept in statistical mechanics. P with the subscript J is the probability that some energy state J will be occupied. The symbol next to it means that it's proportional to, and the expression on the right is the Boltzmann factor, an exponential, e to the negative energy of state J divided by kBT. First, a little terminology. KB is the Boltzmann constant. You've probably seen the gas constant, capital R. And the Boltzmann constant is just the single particle version of the gas constant. It's R divided by Avogadro's number, which in SI units is equal to 1.38 times 10 to the negative 23 joules per Kelvin. So if you look at the units in that exponent, if we use an energy in joules, a Boltzmann constant in joules per Kelvin, and a temperature in Kelvin, then all of the units in the exponent will cancel out, and the exponent will be unitless. Throughout statistical mechanics, we'll often see a lot of kBTs in the denominator, so you'll sometimes see 1 over kBT written as the Greek letter beta in shorthand. So a Boltzmann factor can alternatively be written as e to the minus beta times energy. If you look at this whole expression, you'll notice that as the energy gets higher, the exponent becomes a larger negative number, and so as the energy gets higher, the probability of occupying a state gets smaller. That makes sense. As we said, lower energy states are more likely to be occupied than higher energy states. Also notice that as the energy gets higher, probability doesn't just get lower, it gets lower really quickly. It goes as an exponential. I'd like to say a couple more things about this expression to help us wrap our minds around the idea of Boltzmann factors. First of all, numerically, kBT is really small. We saw that KB is on the order of 10 to the minus 23 joules per Kelvin. And most of the time, we're thinking about temperatures that are in the hundreds of Kelvin. So around room temperature, KB times T is on the order of 10 to the minus 21 joules. The upshot of that is that if the energy levels of an atom or molecule are spaced much farther apart than 10 to the minus 21 joules, then really only the ground state will have significant occupation. It's only when the energy levels of an atom or molecule are really close together, on the order of 10 to the minus 21 joules, that we see significant population of the excited states. Also, remember that our absolute definition of energy is arbitrary, and it's really only differences in energy that are meaningful. That means that the relative probabilities of two states being occupied must only depend on the difference in energy, and we can show that. The ratio of the probabilities of two states being occupied, Pi divided by Pj, can be written as a quotient of Boltzmann factors, and if we remember our exponent rules, if we divide one exponential by another, we subtract the two exponents, and we can see that the quotient of those two probabilities does in fact depend only on the difference between the energies. That's something that had to be true, because our definition of zero energy was arbitrary. So far, we've said that the probability that a state is occupied is proportional to the Boltzmann factor. But we haven't yet said what the probability is equal to, and that's something that we'll often want to calculate. To figure out what a probability is equal to, we basically just need to ensure that the probabilities of all possible outcomes add up to 1, because that's how probabilities work. So, in order to find a probability, pj, we need to take the corresponding Boltzmann factor and divide it by a normalization constant, which is basically just a sum of all of the possible Boltzmann factors. For example, if an electron has 3 possible states that it can be in, the normalization constant is just the sum of the Boltzmann factors for those 3 states. In statistical mechanics, we actually give this normalization constant a name. It's called the partition function. It may seem a little bit silly at first that we give a name to this normalization constant, but it turns out that this partition function is actually very powerful, and it can tell us a lot just by itself. So for now, just be aware that this is called the partition function, it's often symbolized by the letter Q, and that we'll be seeing a lot of this in the upcoming videos. For the remainder of this video, I'd like to work through an extended example, where we try to make some numerical sense of Boltzmann factors and partition functions and what they mean. We're going to look at a particle that has 3 possible energy states that we'll call epsilon 0, epsilon 1, and epsilon 2. It doesn't even really matter whether that particle is an electron or an atom or a molecule, you can just think of it as any particle that has 3 possible energy states. And we're going to look at 3 different cases. In case number 1, the 3 energy states are very far apart. They're at 0 joules, 1 joule, and 2 joules. In case number 2, the energy states are spaced by 10 to the minus 20 joules. And in case number 3, the energy states are spaced by 10 to the minus 40 joules. Notice that the way I've drawn these 3 cases are not even close to scale. From one case to the next, the energy spacing is different by many orders of magnitude, and that's not what I've drawn. I've just tried to make it clear that the energy spacing goes from big to medium to small. What we're going to do is, at 300 Kelvin, at room temperature, we're going to find the partition functions for each of these 3 cases, and the probability that each of the 3 energy states is occupied. Before we calculate any numbers here, I'd like you to take a few seconds to think about how you expect these cases to come out, specifically in terms of the occupation probabilities. In cases 1 through 3, do you expect it to mainly be one state that's occupied? Do you expect all 3 states to be equally occupied? How do you think the relative occupations will turn out? I'll give you a few seconds to think about that, and I suggest hitting pause to take some more time. In case 1, the energy states are spaced really far apart relative to kBT. That means that in case 1, we expect a nearly 100% chance that the ground state, epsilon 0, is occupied. In case 3, the 3 energy states are so close together that they might as well be equal. That means we expect those 3 energy states to be nearly equally occupied, with about 1/3 occupation probability. And case 2 is somewhere in between. The energy spacing is pretty similar to kBT, which means that the ground state will be more occupied than the others, but we expect all 3 states to have some probability of being occupied. So that's what we expect, and we should try to keep that in mind as we work through the numbers on the next slide. The general form of the partition function is shown here. Q equals the sum of the 3 Boltzmann factors corresponding to each of the 3 energy states. To find the Boltzmann factors and partition functions for each case, we just need to plug in the corresponding values of epsilon and t. We'll start with case number 1. In case 1, and for all the cases, epsilon 0 equals 0, so the first term in each partition function is going to be e to the negative 0, which is just 1. In case 1, the 2 excited state energies, epsilon 1 and epsilon 2, are both really high relative to kBT. So that means the second and third terms in the partition function are going to be e raised to the power of a negative really, really large number. And e to a negative really, really large number approaches 0. That means the partition function for case 1 is going to be 1 plus numbers approaching 0, which equals 1. And then if we want to find the probability that each individual energy state is occupied, we just need to take each Boltzmann factor and divide it by the partition function. So the probability that the ground state is occupied is 1 divided by 1, which is 1. That's what we expected, 100% probability that the ground state is occupied in this case. And then the probability that each of the excited states are occupied is just the Boltzmann factor, which approaches zero, divided by the partition function. So those probabilities approach zero. That's all what we expected. At the other end of the spectrum is case number three. Again, the first term of the partition function equals 1 because it's just e to the negative 0. But in case 3, the excited state energies are also really, really small compared to kBT. So the second and third terms of the partition function are e raised to the power of negative really, really small numbers. And again, those approach e to the 0, which is 1. So in this case, the partition function looks like this. It's the sum of three terms that all approach 1, so the partition function approaches 3. The probabilities that each state is occupied is just each individual Boltzmann factor divided by the partition function, and each of those is going to approach 1 over 3. So as we expected, if the three energy states are infinitesimally close together, their probabilities of being occupied all approach 1/3. Case number 2 is the intermediate case. Again, the first term of the partition function equals 1 because it's just e to the 0. But for the second and third terms, we actually need to plug in the excited state energies and the temperature. It comes out like this. The first term is 1, and the second and third terms get smaller and smaller as the energy gets higher. You can check my math on this, but I got a partition function that's around 1.1. And if we want to find the probabilities of each state being occupied, we again take each Boltzmann factor and divide by the partition function. The probability that the ground state is occupied is 1 divided by the partition function, which is about 91%. So that makes sense. The ground state is the most likely to be occupied. And the probabilities get smaller from there. 8% for the first excited state, and less than 1% for the second excited state. There's one more thing I'd like to point out here. In case number 1, where there's one state that's occupied, the partition function equals 1. In case number 3, where there are three states that are occupied, the partition function equals 3. And in case number 2, where mostly one state is occupied, but a couple other states have some occupation, the partition function is a little bit more than 1. That actually gives us an interesting intuitive interpretation of the partition function. Roughly speaking, the partition function gives us a sense of about how many states have significant occupation, assuming the ground state energy is 0. Again, when just one state was occupied, the partition function approached 1, when three states were equally occupied, it approached 3, and when it was mostly one state but a little bit more in other states, the partition function was a little bit more than 1. There's just one more thing I'd like to do in this video, and that's to introduce a slightly more compact form of the partition function. So far, we've introduced the partition function as a sum over all energy states. We just take each state that the particle might be in and add together the Boltzmann factors for each of those states. In some cases, it's going to be helpful for us to talk not in terms of a sum over all energy states, but a sum over all energy levels, a sum over all energies at which there are any states. So this second form of the partition function looks very similar to the first, except that there's this extra term in here, g with a subscript j. That's the degeneracy at a given energy level. In other words, if we have an energy at which there are three energy states, rather than adding together the Boltzmann factor three times, we can just say that this term is three times one of those Boltzmann factors. This isn't a particularly surprising thing to be saying, but it will be helpful, because as we've seen in quantum mechanics, there are often degeneracies at a given energy level when we're dealing with systems like a particle in a three-dimensional box or atomic orbitals. So when we build up statistical mechanical models of real atoms and molecules, it's going to be helpful for us to express partition functions as sums over degenerate terms. Finally, I'd just like to remind us of a few takeaway lessons from this video. At finite temperature, a particle is more likely to occupy lower energy states than higher energy states. We also saw that intuitively, more closely spaced energy states and higher temperatures tend to lead to more noticeable population of excited states, whereas energy states that are really far apart or at low temperatures tend to lead to almost complete occupation of the ground state. Mathematically, we saw that the probabilities that given states are occupied are governed by the concepts that we introduced in this video, Boltzmann factors and partition functions. While we spent this video looking at how these situations play out when there's only one particle in a given set of energy levels, in the next video we're going to see how things play out when there's more than one particle. That's all for now.